What's going on, everybody? Welcome back to another episode of JaR. JaR, for those of you that may be new, stands for Joe.
And Amy.
Review. This is our weekly show where we go over the magic stories. We review the magic stories. It's getting a little bit harder for us to say that because we haven't had one to review in about 6 or 7 weeks now. but we're getting back to it next week, promise.
Yes.
But in the interim, we have been reviewing the Magic Story podcasts that have been being put out by Blake Rasmussen, interviewing different people that are part of the creative team at Wizards of the Coast, whether that is the story team or, like this week, the member of the art team, or in this case, the art director. So this week we have an interview with Travis Winters, who was the senior art director at Wizards and the art director specifically for Aether Revolt. Mm-hmm. My quick review in the beginning, this was a good one. It was about 20 minutes long. I do have, little comments here or there that I'll save for the review itself, but if you're interested in art in any way, if you're interested in the broad concept of being an artist at Wizards of the Coast, that gets discussed, as well as more specifically the art of Aether Revolt, so it's a little bit of both. And if that's something that you're interested in, I would recommend taking some time and listening to this one before listening to our review, because we don't summarize, we review. So I don't know if you have any other input besides that. Do you agree, disagree?
My quick review is just that I like it a lot, because as we discussed in the last video, I'm a total art geek.
True.
Not everybody is. So if you hate the concept of sitting for 20 minutes and listening to some people talk about basically just art,
mm-hmm.
pretty much, then don't bother watching it.
Fair enough. And I pointed to myself, I'm not an art geek. I don't hate art, but yeah, I'm just not as invested in it as Amy is. I appreciate art. I appreciate looking at it. If it looks nice, I like it. But I couldn't necessarily explain to you why or the mechanics behind it or etc. like Amy could, or presumably like Travis or someone like that could. So, yeah, that's the quick review. We recommend
comparing me to Travis.
I'm comparing you to Travis. I'm comparing you to Travis more than I'm comparing me to Travis.
Okay.
So it's not really
so
a compliment.
Never mind.
Yeah, exactly. So that's the quick review at the beginning. Getting into the review itself, it was light, it was fun, it was quick, it was very quick, because whether you want to take this as a positive or a negative, and I'm honestly not sure how I feel about it yet. I'm not, because I understand why it was there, I just don't know that all of it needed to be there. The first 7+ minutes of this 20-minute interview, and I mean it was 20 minutes and some odd seconds, the first 7+ minutes was Travis talking about his resume, basically. His path to today in Wizards of the Coast. Now, like I said, I understand why it was there, and it was because Blake specifically asked him. People ask us all the time, how do I get a job as an artist at Wizards? But then he didn't say, and I thought this was an interesting way to word this question, Blake didn't say, so how do you become an artist at Wizards? What he said was, what was your path to becoming an artist at Wizards? And again, that's then when Travis gave his resume, which again, makes sense as an answer to that question.
But any one person can't really answer the question that Blake did not ask.
Correct.
And that's
which
why
is why
he didn't ask.
No, and I understand that. I just think it's interesting because I want to know what, I guess I want to know what these Magic Story podcasts are. Because for the first 7+ minutes, they didn't talk about the Magic Story. They talked about how Travis became an artist. Now, I understand that you want to introduce your guest. So that's why I said I don't know how I feel about it. I don't know whether it's a negative, whether it's a positive, whether I'm just saying maybe trim it down a little in the future, because
I think what you're trying to say is that you're missing that feeling of cohesion between the different podcasts. You know, amongst the podcasts that already have been in existence, is there enough cohesion for you to be able to understand the reasoning behind their existence?
Well, okay, but, and I'll counter you with this statement, because everyone else who Blake interviewed during his Magic Story podcasts, which are being put out to replace the weekly Magic Stories, are people who have written weekly Magic Stories. Which means they are names that, if you have been following along, even in just the Aether Revolt story or the Kaladesh block of stories, you know these names. Even if you know nothing about them, you know when he says, oh, this person wrote this story, or, you know, Alison Lures was the creator of Yeheni. You now know who that person is, at least, super specifically. Right. You don't know a lot of the other things that they do, etc. You may not know what a community manager is, for example.
Right.
Just talking about Alison again.
But you, in a very, very, very minute way, know something about this person.
Correct.
And what they do for Wizards.
Correct. As opposed to Travis,
or
who...
what they have in some way done for Wizards.
Right. Who, as opposed to Travis, who, if you are only following the Magic Stories, you wouldn't necessarily know who Travis is. And so, again, I understand...
And that's what made this one cool, but at the same time, like you said, it...
It was just, it was 20 minutes long, and over 7 minutes of it was his resume. So it was more than half of it was, yes, technically talking about art, but not talking about Aether Revolt art. It was talking about how Travis got to
right.
this point. Again, I don't know. I want you guys, as always, to let us know what you think. Do you think that that was okay because you needed that background? Do you think that that background material was too much? Do you think there should have been more? Do you think he should have asked the question of, you know, what do you recommend as a good way? Because his background, one of the things that he mentioned was that he said one, you know, as like almost like a New Year's resolution, he made it seem like, he was like, I am going to get Magic the Gathering work, because he mentioned how he was trying to get D&D work because he started as a fan of D&D. Dungeons and Dragons, if you don't know, technically.
If you don't know what D&D is...
Fair. I just in case, we're talking about Magic here. It's the same company,
I mean,
but it's a different product.
Some of the people I worked with didn't know what D&D was, but they're in no way watching this channel.
True. So yeah, D&D... He tried to get D&D work, and he met Jeremy Jarvis, who, as we know, is part of the Magic team now. He and met Jeremy, basically told him, it's not good enough, get better. And he went and did that. And he said, I beefed up my portfolio. And
yeah, but he said it only took him a year. And I was like, wow, okay, that's kind of impressive.
Well, he said
and
it only took him a year.
And he really didn't dwell on that. And he was just like, oh, so I set this New Year's resolution to you know... Or I sent the thing.
He sent it in at the beginning of the year, and like
year,
a week
and
later.
A week later, he had the job, and I was
yep.
like, "Oh, so why are we talking about this? Because
right.
obviously, his journey isn't necessarily in any way what anyone else's journey would have been. If someone came to me and said your portfolio just isn't good enough, I probably wouldn't then." A year later, assume that it was, and I would feel extremely blessed, let's put it that way, if a year later I sent in my work and then the following week got the job. I would be extremely surprised if that was the result of a year prior to that being told it wasn't good enough.
Yeah, absolutely. No, and that's totally fair, and I mean, he did... kind of, again, in those 7 minutes, delve into his background and his knowledge and how he got to even that point of being rejected by Jeremy that first time. And so you get that kind of a background, which is fine. It just, you know, again, for those first 7 minutes, I heard nothing relating to the Magic Story whatsoever in this Magic Story podcast, that by the time it was half over, I had barely heard anything about the Magic Story.
Yeah.
Which, again... I don't mind.
This is supposed to be about the art.
That's fine. Then it's not a Magic Story podcast. You know what I mean? Then it's a Vorthos podcast, because Vorthos is care about it. Look,
maybe you're just getting too damn picky.
Fair.
There's only so many, you know, topics they can really talk about a set that's over.
And we will, like, and
set,
we will,
this, that is over.
And we'll talk about that at the end, because we want to do kind of a wrap up on the podcasts at the end. More on this one. There were definitely good things too. Please don't think that as I said in the beginning, I thought this one was good. I liked the discussion that the two of them had. I liked the fact that Travis was able to say that he started out because he liked D&D, and he drew his character in D&D, and then his friend's characters in D&D, and he liked Transformers, and so he drew that. And again, from a geek channel perspective, from a geek's perspective, I love hearing that. I love hearing that one of our own is able to use his love and his passion to get him a job that he now loves and has passion for. So, yeah.
It made me think of you when he said that, actually.
Really?
Yeah.
Yeah, see? So, but again, I'm not a good artist, so maybe into something
bad.
Different.
You're not bad.
Anyway.
You're good at drawing Pokemon.
Thank you. I haven't done that in years. But yes.
But you're good at drawing Pokemon.
Thank you.
Which is why it made me think of that.
Fair.
Because, you know, you're probably good at drawing things that you are, you know, a geek for.
And I will say practice makes perfect.
Yeah.
Because when I first started out, I was not. But, you know, getting there and practicing, etc. is very important. So I'll definitely mention that. Talking more about what Travis eventually got into with, you know, Aether Revolt specific information, he talked about I liked, and I'm sure you'll have more to say about it because I'm not going to be able to get into the technicalities of it, but I really appreciated when he talked about the difference in the way that consulate images were drawn and rebel images were drawn. I like how he said, you know, he specified that the consulate was supposed to look fascist. The consulate had, they had, when they were showing images of the consulate, the skyline of Kaladesh was different than it was shown in Kaladesh, because you needed them to look more imposing, maybe a little bit, maybe, and I don't think he said this, but I'll say, maybe a little bit more industrial and not so in tune with nature, in tune with ether. There were very flat skylines as opposed to domed buildings or things like that. So I liked
swirls,
that a lot.
Swirls, you know,
right.
Were very prominent in Kaladesh and either completely gone or mostly gone in Aether Revolt.
Right. And
although it was still the same plane.
Right. So I figured I'd bring that up and then let you kind of take over with that, because I don't have a lot of that background, but I that was something that I took away that I appreciated hearing about was the difference in, you know, the fact that then when you look at rebel cards, you know, they had like more Dutch angles or were being shown from above or below as opposed to straight on, and it's like it was set up on a tripod and that's how you're seeing it, as opposed to handheld and it's all different directions or whatever. So yeah
so he was referencing cinematography when he was talking about that.
Correct.
But last week in JaAR, I mentioned composition. Now, Ari Levitch didn't actually say the word composition or even really anything alluding to that in his podcast.
Mm-hmm.
That's just something it made me think of because of the sort of things that he said, the sort of aspects he was talking about, where he was basically saying that the art had such a way of making you think or feel a certain way.
Mm-hmm.
And it made me think of composition, because to me that's a very effective artistic device in doing that. And that was very prominently mentioned in this week's podcast, because he spoke specifically about composition, and he used cinema as his sort of inspiration, and he was talking about movies that had fascism in them, and saying, okay, so these frames would be shot in such a way that would give you that feel of structure,
right,
and intensity, and then the other frames would be you know, giving you the sense that the people being shot in those frames have less of less of an adherence to that structure.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, and he talked about, like I said, he talked about the different shots and things like that, but he talked about you were mentioning earlier, their, he was able to show their appreciation for order, their appreciation for, you know, there is no wiggle room, there is no
right.
tilt
so
it this way,
is,
tilt it that
know,
way.
Everything is a grid, you know, everything is very straight lines
yep.
and very, you know, orderly, and then, you know, depicting the rebels, you know, would be very, you know, sort of, okay, what kind of, like, interesting angles can
mm-hmm.
we get it at? And
yeah, outside the
know.
Box thinking kind
yeah.
of thing. Yeah, definitely. So, thank you, because I that was definitely something that I took away, and even, again, I put it up at the beginning, but if you watched last week's JaAR, I was there, and Amy talked about composition, and so I learned about composition, and so when he talked about it today, I was like, hey, I know what that means. Amy told me about it last week. So it was, you come to JaAR and you learn something. At least I came to JaAR and learned something last week. But yeah, so I appreciated that. I appreciated, like, you know, there's your cohesion from week to week, is that,
right.
you know, you get to learn one thing one week and then utilize that knowledge the next week. So I did. I liked that a lot. He talked
about... I
liked
it too, because it made me feel like what I brought up last week was actually valid.
he talked about vehicles. He talked about consistency with legend cards or characters that are depicted on cards like Karizev and Baral and etc. I don't have a lot to say about that. I thought those segments were cool, and I appreciated those segments, and I thought that was all good information. I don't really have much more to say about that. I don't know, again, from your perspective. Please,
I mean, obviously, trying to keep the legendary characters, and pretty
mm-hmm.
much just any, like, sort of main characters
mm-hmm.
in anything, really, any sort of media, as consistent as possible is a really big deal.
Especially with different artists drawing them
exactly,
on different cards.
Exactly, because if you see this picture of Chandra, and you see a different picture of Chandra, and you see a different picture of Chandra, you need to still be able to recognize her as Chandra
mm-hmm.
in all three of the pictures.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, you can definitely tell a difference in all three of those pictures based on the fact that the artist was different. So that's why at this point, when they're so focused on the Gatewatch, specifically those characters, I think they're really trying to keep that consistency. You know, they're really trying harder than normal to keep that consistency, because I think that that's kind of one of the ways in which they're saying it's important. These characters are important. So how they look shouldn't really change, because it needs to be recognizable to someone who's as into magic as Joe, but also to someone who just got into it and doesn't know any of these characters from Adam,
right.
looking at old cards and new cards and being able to recognize that they're both the same character.
That's fair. And
an important character.
And
as a result, I guess.
Yeah, and even someone like me, the thing that it makes me think of, I'm moving slightly out of the realm of art, but I'll bring it back, I promise, is when we talk about Gideon. There are so many images of Gideon out there, and so many depictions of Gideon out there in many different places.
Yeah.
And Gideon...
And a lot of them look really different from
yes,
each other.
Because Gideon is supposed to be darker skinned. He is supposed to be from the desert. You know, he's supposed to be from, like, very dark olive-skinned, if you will.
Yeah.
And honestly, with the way that he's depicted on cards, that's not, in my opinion...
It's like a spectrum.
Yes.
Like a,
but I will say...
A whole spectrum.
If you look at the pop figurine of Gideon, I looked at that pop figurine and I was like, who is this? Because his skin is very dark in the pop figurine, and in the art it doesn't look that way to me, or it didn't look that way to me. Now that I know what I'm looking for, it's a little bit easier to try to see, oh, okay, they're trying here, they're trying there. But that's what it makes me think of when you talk about the importance of making them look consistent, because you specified that I would be different than someone who just started playing the game. But in certain cases, I'm not.
Yeah.
I've been playing the game, you know, for, what, 20 years now or something crazy? And
oh, God.
Maybe it hasn't quite
There's
been 20
no
years.
There's no way it's been that long.
I don't know. It's been close. I'm sure if any of our viewers are older than us, they hate you right now.
Oh, God. I've
been playing the game long enough, and yet I can still look at Gideon as a pop figurine, one of the main five, you know, Origins Planeswalkers, and go, who is that? So I can absolutely understand the importance of needing to draw them consistently, portray them consistently, whatever you want to say.
And I think Gideon was the perfect example because I think for the most part, all of the other Gatewatch members, even the newer ones like Ajani,
well,
have been depicted pretty similarly.
Ajani's not that hard, though. He's one, the only Leonin Planeswalker. Two, he's got a damn scar over his eye.
No, I'm just saying,
but
like, all different iterations of his art that I have seen are similar enough for me to be able to say, oh, that's Ajani?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I see that.
Fair. Fair enough.
Whereas some of the Gideon ones, maybe not as much.
Yeah.
But I think they've chosen what they want to go with Gideon, and they're going to try and stick to that now.
Right.
So
yeah, no, absolutely. And I understand that. I also appreciated, and again, this one I'll gloss over, but if you want to take more time on it, you're more than welcome to. I appreciated that he mentioned Blake, I keep saying he, there were two men involved, so I'll try to specify. Blake asked Travis about what his favorite, or what maybe if there were some hidden Easter eggs in art in this set. And Travis specified, he was like, I don't really want to do that. And he kind of called out Magic fans a little bit, where he was like, if I say, oh, this piece of art, a lot of fans are going to be like, please, dude, everyone knows that. Come
right.
on, you're an idiot. You know. And honestly, in certain circles, there are definitely people who would do that, who would like tweeted him and be like, are you stupid? Of course I saw that.
Right.
And that's really rude, first of all, so please don't do that.
I think his point was trying to say that he specifically is not very adept, maybe, at picking up on those sorts of things himself. So he wouldn't sit there and act like, you know, he knows all of these things that are just, as he put it, so clever.
Well,
and then, you know, have all the fans be like, yeah, duh.
I don't know that I necessarily agree, only because it's not about him being able to figure it out, because he was the one who asked them to draw
that.
Okay.
I'm just saying, like, I think he's building that wall because he recognizes in himself that perhaps he is not the best at that particular thing.
Okay, that's fair. And I don't know. I really don't, right? I know that the thing that he did bring up was the masterpieces, which I have not seen a lot of masterpieces because you gotta be real lucky to open them.
Really has.
I mean, obviously I've seen them online. Don't get me wrong.
Well,
that's not what I'm saying. But I haven't seen a lot in person, and I haven't, like, analyzed a lot of the art like I would if I had the card sitting in front of me. That's when I get the time to sit and admire and enjoy it. Looking at it on a computer screen, sure, I have all the time in the world to do it, but I just won't necessarily because it's not the same. But
what did he say about the masterpieces, though?
I was just going to say that. So he talked about the fact that the Aether Revolt masterpieces, now they're just called the Kaladesh Masterpiece Series or the Inventions, but the Aether Revolt Inventions specifically, he said, were being depicted as inventions that were stolen by the Consulate. And so the backgrounds,
I thought that was really cool.
Yeah, so did I. That's why I have it written down here to talk about, because I thought that was great, was that all of those masterpieces in the background are shown in an interior setting. He mentions Worm Coil Engine because it's a little bit too big, but that all the other ones have been stolen or confiscated or whatever you want to call it, and so are indoors. I thought that that was very interesting, and is not something, as I said, I have noticed because I didn't have a lot of time to look at them. But
I thought the coolest part was that he mentioned that Coil Engine because that shows that not only did they decide that all of these inventions had been stolen by the consulate to make the art for all of those cards, but they also then decided that this other thing is too large for whatever the storage facility could have possibly been.
I think he specified
so
it was
that,
a museum, but
so that it had to be outdoors. And that was the only one that was.
Which is really cool.
Or one of the few that was.
Right.
If it was a couple.
Right, because he only specified Wormcoin,
right.
But it's possible that there were others. But yeah, so I thought that was cool.
I thought that was super cool.
I wanted to mention that.
And that kind of goes back to the vehicles, which we kind of glossed over before. And I just love vehicles, so I could talk about vehicles for forever and a day. But I thought it was really cool what he said, like, trying to sort of make the vehicles very, very unique, but at the same time, making them recognizable as vehicles.
Correct.
Even though the pieces that were used to make them function are very different than what they really would be in
than
real
what
life.
Than what we would understand
right.
them to be. Yeah, exactly. The last thing that I had written down that I wanted to talk about before we go into the wrap-up of the podcasts in general was just the crazy. I literally didn't believe it when I heard it, but the craziness of Travis mentioning that when Blake asked him what he's working on now, he talked about what he's working on now, which is stuff that we'll release in 2018, but then specified that he's done concept art for sets that will be released in 10 plus years.
Yeah.
That is insane to me.
And I loved Blake's reaction where he was like, whoa, I didn't even know that.
Yeah, yeah.
Like,
which,
yeah.
Because I wouldn't be surprised if they said we're doing stuff 4 years out, 5 years out.
Right.
That's not as surprising to me.
A lot.
10 years is a very, very long time. And so when you look, this kind of properly segues into what we're talking about next. When you look at doing things like these, like podcasts, like panels and things like that, we, as consumers, as fans, as players, whatever you want to call us, Vorthos, etc., when we approach...
#VorthosPride.
When we approach these people, the creative team, etc., and we say to them, tell us about this, tell us about that, why didn't you do this, why didn't you do that, they may have done that 10 years ago. And that seems a little extreme, but they may have done it 2 years ago, and they may be three sets into the future. And that's why it's so shocking to me that they still do so many things like this.
Right.
And I guess...
And, like, everybody's job is different, but think about your job for a second. You know, take the time to think about your job for a second. And think about the details and the complexities of a certain project that you had to work on. And then think about if it would be even possible for you to remember that stuff 10 years from now.
And if you have a sick, if you have a sick memory and you can, congrats to you. And if your job needs you to do that, then, you know, go ask for a raise or something, because props. But,
yeah.
Like, it is. It's very, very difficult.
Because I can't fathom doing something like that.
Yeah, I could probably... I can...
There's no way that I would be able to remember closely enough the things that I would need to remember to be able to have these detailed interviews where I explain all of the aspects of the world building and stuff like that.
Yeah.
I don't care how detailed and specific and thought-provoking all of it was, there's no way I would be able to give an accurate description and depiction of it 10 years later. There's
yeah.
no way.
No.
Because I would just, I would not remember.
Yeah. Absolutely. And I mean, you know, the example that I thought of off the top of my head was I don't remember what I paid for gas this past weekend. Like, you know, per gallon for gas. I don't know, who the hell remembers? It was so long ago. But, you know, these guys are thinking back that far. And so I can understand us as fans being like, you know, rabid fan base,
right.
being like, tell us these things we want to know.
And
they're
like,
all
those Easter eggs, like you mentioned before. And it's like, okay, but do they even remember if there were any?
Right.
You know, and so, if there were, are they something that even will carry on to fruition, I guess,
mm-hmm.
you know, like the way they intended them to 10 years ago.
Right.
You know, it's like, yeah.
Yeah. And so that would probably, in my opinion, be the end of our review of this podcast. Bear with us. There's probably a little bit more time down below because I wanted to just close as requested by Blake himself at the end of this podcast and a couple of times throughout. But I wanted to close by just broadly going over these podcasts. There were 6 of them. We did the jars for them. You can go back and watch them.
Yes.
If you're interested, of course. And you should go back and listen to them so that you have an accurate opinion if and when you go share that opinion with Blake and or with the Magic Twitter, because that is what he requested, was to share it with him on Twitter or with Magic itself on Twitter and let them know what you thought. And you better believe...
That part's going to be really important.
Yeah, and you better believe that we're going to do that. We are going to do that. We're going to put forth our opinion because we were here reviewing it for weeks. And
right.
We are showing off our hashtag Vorthos Pride, like Amy said.
Yeah.
But it's important to us because this was, and I'll start off by saying this, this was an infinite step forward in comparison to what they did between Kaladesh and Aether Revolt, or between Eldritch Moon and Kaladesh. Infinite improvement.
Yes.
By a lot. And again, we've been doing JaAR for a while, as you can see from the episode number down below. We've been doing JaAR for a while.
Another thing that makes me feel old.
And we have slogged through those things. And we have now gotten to this point. Is this a perfect system? In my opinion, no. Is it infinitely better? Yes. And so I applaud Blake and his guests for that. I think that it was... And I applaud Blake... specifically for being honest when he went into this. And I said this in the beginning of these podcasts as well. I applaud Blake for going into this and saying, hey, look, these periods of time in between the stories have not been the best. And so we're looking for something to fill that void, and this is something that we are trying. We are trying it, so please let us know what you think. And so,
but it's also something that they're trying based on the fact that fans have been asking for it.
Correct.
It's not something that they just pulled out their butts.
Correct.
And we're like, oh, well, you wanted something, this?
Correct. And so, like I said, I like it. I liked the thought behind it. Is it perfect? No. Now, we have discussed our opinions. I feel like with these podcasts in particular, it was mostly me who was being negative about it. So, for that, I guess I apologize, but at the same time...
Well, I think it's a little hard to actually critique them at this point. Because like you said, like we talked about before, there's not a ton of cohesion between them. And you find yourself asking if there has to be, and then...
I was just going
to
say that. I don't think there does.
And then asking, well, maybe there should be. I don't know.
No.
And I think until we have the next set, and then the next set after that of podcasts, not of cards, obviously.
Fair.
We won't have something to compare it to well enough to say... You know, like, when the next set of podcasts comes out, we can listen to all of those and go, okay, well, these ones were better than the last ones because...
Well, and...
But we can't really do that yet. All we can say is the things that we liked and the things that we didn't. And I think this early on, there's just going to be a lot of those, and they're going to be conflicting.
Well, but realize... that we don't know if there are going to be other podcasts.
Right.
Because people have to share their opinions first.
Right.
So it's kind of a catch-22 in that you feel like you can't because we don't have more, but we're not going to have more if we don't give our opinions.
Right.
So here's my thought on this whole thing. I guess I'll Jerry Springer with some final thoughts. Ugh, that's really sleazy.
That's gross.
I'm sorry, everyone. if you don't get that joke, congrats. Don't look it up.
Yeah. If you don't get that joke, then we are old.
Save yourself the time. Yeah, I'll give my final thoughts. My final thoughts are that it was very good. I appreciated hearing from these people who write these stories that we love and that we consume, again, ravenously at times, because we love them so much and we want to hear more and we want to learn more and we want to read more and we want... It's kind of... Now, speaking of sounding old, I feel like it's the culture that we live in now, where if you are a person who is a celebrity in that... And that's not to insult anyone, I'm just saying... They're not celebrities as we would consider them to be traditional celebrities, but they're celebrities in that they have a fan base. They have a group of people who enjoy their work, who consume their work, and who want to meet them, who want to talk to them, who want to hear their opinions. And with the world of Twitter, you know, I can personally say, for me, for people that have watched JaAR, the fact that Chris Letoire doesn't have a Twitter, the fact that Chris Letoire hasn't been on this podcast, is driving me crazy. Because I want so much more of what that man has to offer. It literally bothers me at times that I don't know more about him, because I want to know. He's so good. He has written two of my favorite stories of all time in Magic. And it's just, it was just incredible. And so when I look up his bio and I look for his Twitter and I can't find it, that makes me sad a little bit, because I want to know more about him. Now, can I understand if he wants his privacy and doesn't want to hear from me? Yes. You know, I could totally get that. And so...
Yeah.
Because
a lot of people don't want to hear from us.
I was wondering when it was going to get back to that. Yes, that's fair. But it also kind of goes back to what I've said a couple of times now, is that I feel like the best version of these would be if you took fan questions. Now, I don't know if there were enough, because Blake did ask for them in the beginning. I don't know if there were enough to fill all of these podcasts, or if he had to make up some questions and then add some other ones, some actual fan questions in there. But I appreciated, and I brought this up very early on, I appreciated Mark Rosewater's version in Odds and Ends, where he asks people for questions, they submit those questions, and then he shares a question. And it's a text article, so I get that. It's a little bit different and difficult. Right. But putting the text up there to give that person a little bit of a shout out for asking a good question, a thought-provoking question that is good enough that you feel like you can create secondary content from that question in of itself, that is a reward to that person. That is a reward that will make your fans want to ask questions, because some people might just be like, whatever, I'm curious, but I don't care enough because whatever. But if there's a possibility that they're going to get shown off, that they're going to get, you know, that 2 seconds of fame of, hey, that guy's question was pretty good. Like, maybe that's what fans want. The other thing that I will say is there's something to be said for this being a podcast versus a video. This in particular was one about art. And it was not visual. It was only audio. I don't understand how you have a podcast about visual stimuli without that visual stimuli. And I get it. Because when he talks about Leaving the Dust, I can go look up the picture of Leaving the Dust. Because, you know, it's our thumbnail and so you'll have seen that. But regardless, you can go look up those pictures that he talks about. But why not show them?
Yeah.
Why not have that video? And I think that's my biggest takeaway from this. Those two things. Fan questions being the priority, and that the concept was great. I personally would prefer video over audio, if only because then you can put up a picture of a card that you're talking about. And that happened a lot, where they talked about different cards, and I knew what they looked like. because I'd played the set, I'd open the set.
Right.
But if you're...
Most people probably don't offhand know what that card looks like.
Correct. And so to show it to
them... He has an odd, specific, obsessive memory of those things, but most people don't.
It's true. And honestly, if you're talking about the art on a card, and you're talking about the flavor, because there were times where they were like, oh, it's great because that card art does exactly what the text says that it should do. And then they don't tell you what the text is.
Yeah.
Well, I'm sorry, I haven't memorized every ability of every card. And so that's something else that can be done, is that you can show us the card. You can show us the text box, or you can just show us the full art image if it is just a discussion on the image itself.
Yeah.
And I think that would be another step up, another way of improving, when I hope that they do another round of podcasts.
Yeah.
And I hope that they showcase the same people and different people. We obviously can't have Melody anymore because she left, which is sad. But...
Oh. I knew you.
But it, you can still have those people come back. And they can answer, hopefully, different questions. And again, let your fans be the ones to dictate the questions, if at all possible. That's my opinion. That's those, again, those are my final thoughts. As always, we want to hear your final thoughts.
Yes.
I also don't want to cut you off if you had anything to add, but I feel like you were adding throughout, so I don't know.
I don't think so.
Okay. Didn't want to steal your spotlight there, because
well,
I know I talked a lot there.
I don't know, maybe a little bit.
Okay, go ahead.
You know, I still like the idea of it not being only fan questions, because like I said before, well, not in this jar, but in one of the previous jars, you know, I talked about the fact that questions I didn't know I had got answered. And there's no way to... There very well may be no way for the audience or the consumer to have specific enough knowledge to ask a detailed enough question to make that really happen. Like, the people who were involved can say something that is so unique and so specific to the process that we couldn't, we couldn't possibly think up that question because
we don't have that
background.
We
weren't there,
mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
So, I mean, I think that there's a lot to be said about that because the things that were my takeaways from all of these were the things that I didn't know I didn't know.
Mm-hmm.
Because, like we said, I mean, we spend so much time looking at PAX videos, you know, of the panels and Inside R&D and reading those Mark Rosewater articles and everything so that we have the most comprehensive look at a plane that we can have.
Mm-hmm.
And listening to these podcasts made that a lot more comprehensive, in my opinion. Although a lot of it was repeat information because a lot of it was stuff that we had already seen or heard or whatever,
mm-hmm.
or read, because we were looking for that.
Mm-hmm.
But a lot of it was, or maybe not even a lot of it, just enough of it to me was information that I would not have known and could not have asked to know.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm thankful for that at the very least. And I like the fact that there were some fan questions and there were also things that were not fan questions, because I think you're worried about repeat information, I think fan questions are going to be repetitive.
That's fair, because those people may not have seen the things that we have seen. That's fair. And the last thing I'll add in is one of the other things that we both really enjoyed was Allison, during her interview, picked some questions herself, which meant that she had thoughts in her head of how she would answer them, and Allison is funny enough and inventive enough to have answered them creatively and entertainingly enough where it worked out very well that she did that. So if you have people who are as talented as Allison in that respect, then let them, you know, take a page out of her book and pick some questions for themselves out of the myriad of questions. Asked.
And that's why I said, you know, it makes a lot of sense for Allison's to be centered around that, but it doesn't necessarily make a lot of sense for them all to be like that.
Correct.
Because, I mean, that's Allison's job.
So, in closing, guys, I personally, and from Amy and I, again, I wanted to say thank you to Blake. I think that he did an awesome job with compiling all these questions. If there were compilations of fan questions, creating his own to showcase these individuals. I'm going to see if I can do this in order because I don't have it written down, but I think I have it in my head. I want to say thank you to Doug. I want to say thank you to James. I want to say thank you to Mel. I want to say thank you to Allison, Ari, and Travis. For all of these, I think I did them in order as well. I could be wrong. But I want to thank all of them for that as well. I think they all did a great job. They took time to make these, etc. And Blake is taking the time to hear the feedback. Magic's Twitter account is taking the time to hear the feedback. So I encourage you, if you listened to those podcasts, to give them your opinion. We never want you to adopt our opinion without watching them. That's the whole point of the mini reviews in the beginning. Correct. And so, you know, we love you all very much, but we don't need you to go out there and be like, well, Joe and Amy said this. If you agree with us after having listened to it and formed your own opinion, that's fine, and we appreciate that, but
we'd love to hear that. Correct. That would be really awesome.
But we want you to be able to give your own opinions as well. To Blake, to the Magic Twitter, whomever it is.
To us.
Correct. In the comments down below, as always.
Yeah, but maybe you completely disagree with us. We want to hear that too.
Please, absolutely. And just continue to show off, as we do, your
Hashtag Morthos Pride.
This time, because we haven't said it in forever, we said it like 6 times in this episode.
it's been building up.
So thank you guys so much for watching.
Morthos Pride withdrawal.
Yes, exactly. I have been Joe.
And I'm Amy.
This is Geek for All. And as we always say, in whichever video of ours you watch next, we will see you all next time. Thanks, everybody.